work session for the Council of the City of Norfolk will now commence. Mr. Roberts, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mayor, Vice Mayor, Members of City Council. We just have one item for presentation under the 3:30 meeting open session. That'll be the city planning update from Mr. Khan. Following that, we have several items for consideration for closed session motion. Without any objection or amendments, we could jump right into the city planning update. I have Mr. John do that for you.
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Mayor, Vice Mayor, Members of City Council, I have a few items to go over for your planning update. One item is will be considered today. One item will be considered next week that I'll speak to because there was a request for a change in condition. And the other items, for the most part, will be heard on August when you return back from the recess. With one item that I just want to speak towards that you're probably getting phone calls on that will be heard in September. So I will get started. The one item that's on today's agenda is Boyle Bay Seafood for a conditional use permit to add entertainment to this location. It's an existing restaurant, and this was continued generally at the April 23rd public hearing. These are the hours of operations and the occupancy of the site. It is a large establishment and a restaurant that has operated as a restaurant in multiple forms over the years. They had requested previously to have live bands and karaoke. They have changed their request to only karaoke at this time.
Yes, sir. Would they still be allowed
to have a live band if they desire to under this?
No, yes, sir.
Okay.
No,
all right, sir. Thank you.
Here's the floor plan of the location. For those that have been with the city for a while, this is the old CompUSA building that has a very large floor plate and has been multiple restaurants over many years. The area in the middle there, that's that rectangle, is the location of the karaoke that they had proposed. At the time when the Planning Commission heard it, they did recommend this for approval with 470 vote. The facility is located within a shopping center and has limited hours of operation, and the applicant is now only proposing karaoke as their only form of entertainment. One item, as I'll transition real quick, that I do not have a slide for, Sunflower Florist next week will be heard by the City Council. Sunflower Florist is an existing florist shop on Collie Avenue that is seeking to provide for off-premises with the sale of flowers and arrangements that they have. They have misinformed staff, but we are correcting at this moment, that they did not, that they do want to provide delivery of off-premises alcohol with the bouquets and other arrangements. There was a condition that limited it, so I wanted to bring attention to that, that we are, that staff has removed that condition from the recommendation. That wasn't of any concern. We were just reflecting their request. Along with that, they would have to meet any ABC requirement for any delivery or of off-premise, so that will also be required. Going on to the items that will be heard in August when you return from recess, the first item is a text amendment by the City Planning Commission, and this amendment would allow for the additional uses of shipping containers in certain zoning districts. Currently, right now, shipping containers are permitted in industrial, business commerce districts, as well as the institutional districts to be utilized for storage, and of course, for their primary use, they can be used for shipping. This would allow for shipping containers to be allowed for permanent storage in commercial districts and commercial regional districts, or typical commercial districts. And this was a request of the Planning Commission. As we look at these, we do know that there's a possibility to utilize them in a way that won't be have an impact on visual as well as impact on the operations of commercial buildings. Some of the proposed language in this requires that there's only one per lot with the potential of having an additional container for storage for every additional 100-foot of lot frontage, no stacking of these, screening them from view or finishing them, or having a clad exterior, and with a general requirement that they must be maintained and rust-free.
So are these shipping containers only allowed to be used for storage, recognizing that they're now being used in other communities for office space and living space?
Correct. So anything that's used for office space or living space is considered another construction material and can be done right as of right now. This is allowing for the placement of a shipping container to be used for storage. So that does not, the zoning ordinance does not prohibit the utilization of shipping containers as building materials to be used for offices and other uses. Again, shipping containers are already permitted for storage in industrial, business commerce, and institutional zoning districts. Again, mostly to provide for either temporary or other storage opportunities. The text amendment also does clarify the language for temporary storage for shipping containers. As we know, our retailers utilize them during the holiday season. There used to be a provision that said the seasonal storage was 30 days at any one time. We knew that as the shopping season gets pushed further back, we just decided to propose removing the 30-day limitation and just sticking to the overall limitation, which was 90 days, which was already existing in the ordinance. And also that clarifies that containers affixed to wheeled devices are excluded. So anything that's actually on a wheeled device is not considered a shipping container because it is able to be moved. The City Planning Commission recommends this by a 5-0 vote. Next item is also another zoning text amendment. There's a zoning text amendment to allow for the creation of new lots that do not meet the minimum lot sizes by conditional use permit. What we've seen over the last few years is that the Board of Zoning Appeals has been granting a disproportionate number of variances to lot size dimensional minimums, so width and area. The variance process is a quasi-judicial process which does not have as much public input as the conditional use permit process. And the note that there are a significant number of variances that have come out of the Board of Zoning Appeals to allow for smaller lots to be developed notes that there is at a higher level a policy issue that needs to be addressed. The text amendment proposes that the creation of a zoning lot that doesn't meet the dimensional standards for lot size be applied for by granting a conditional use permit. Since there is a path for an applicant to go forward to request a smaller lot size, it will remove it from the Board of Zoning Appeals purview to the City Council's Planning Commission and City Council's purview with the additional public hearing and public input process required by the conditional use permit. The analysis that will be provided through this would be analysis of existing lot patterns, which includes the built environment, public input, of course the robust public input that's required, as well as the comprehensive plan, which calls out typical lot sizes in certain areas of the city depending on what character district they are and what zoning type they are, as well as the need for potential for affordable housing and other issues that could be brought forward if seen fit as part of the application process. The limitation does limit it to the construction of single-family homes only, so this wouldn't be able to create a lot that doesn't meet the minimum dimensional standards to create a multifamily use. It would only be for single-family. The amendment does not allow for the lot size to go less than 25 feet, which is what our current minimum is in certain zoning districts. So our historic districts, as well as Huntersville, have a minimum standard of 25 feet. So we won't allow anything smaller than that. And this will require architectural design to be compatible with the neighborhood. So it will require architectural review by staff or through the Architectural Review Board for this process. By a vote of 5-0, the Planning Commission does recommend approval of this request. Next item is by Family Food Mart for a conditional use permit at 6819 Souls Point Road. This is an existing convenience store, and the conditional use permit is to allow the existing convenience store to sell alcoholic beverages for off-premise consumption. The site has operated as a convenience store since 1961. The property is currently vested for a convenience store as well as the sale of smoking products. It does not have the approval to sell off-premises alcohol beverages. In 2012, they made a request for a special exception for off-premise alcohol sales, and it was denied by the council. In 2021, a similar request, a conditional use permit for the sale of alcohol off-premises was also denied by the City Council. Here's the location. It's an existing, again, a noted existing convenience store. On this corner here on Souls Point Road. The plan on the right was offered by the applicant to improve the driveway access and to provide plantings on the location as well as providing necessary screening. By a vote of 5-0, the Planning Commission does recommend approval. Commissioners that voted in support of it noted that they wanted to try to support a small business trying to improve the property. Staff did receive a letter of opposition from the Coronado Inglenook Civic League. Any questions here?
You said they didn't.
They did.
They received opposition.
We did receive a letter of opposition from the Coronado English.
This is across the street from Norview High School.
Next item is Savannah House Rentals LLC for conditional use permit for a short-term rental. This is at 1547 Crane Avenue. It's an existing single-family home, and the applicant is proposing to do a short-term rental for as a homestay. Here's the neighborhood analysis. There aren't very many short-term rentals in this area, but the applicant had a previous administrative approval, and now they're looking to obtain a conditional use permit for the homestay short-term rental. Here's the property, single family home. Again, has sufficient parking on site.
Is there, and I think I probably know the answer, so my apologies, but is there a mechanism to know how much revenue that this has generated for the city or any short-term rental? When they come up for a, or if they are up to date and paying their fees?
We do check with the Commissioner of Revenue to make sure that they're up to date with providing payments for those fees. As far as direct benefit, staff does not have an analysis for that.
So we can't find that out, can we?
Well, you'd be asking about the specific tax account for the specific property owner, so you're welcome to ask the applicant. If she would like to disclose it, she can, but if she's unwilling to disclose it, it would be confidential.
It's just the real estate taxes, that's it.
Okay.
And there's no active civic league in that area right now, so I'm assuming they held the meeting.
Correct. They held a public meeting because there's no active civic league. There were concerns from those that were that did attend the meeting. One speaker did speak in opposition, noting issues with the previous short-term rental tenants and parking on the location, which would have been mitigated if they meet the current requirements for notification, as well as the posting of the sign for the operator and having someone operate be there in time to mitigate the issue. The Planning Commission did recommend a 5-0 vote approval of this request.
Mr. Johnson.
Does this property have any violations?
This property had previously had had a violation for operating without a conditional use permit. The applicant did cease listing the property in order to be put on the agenda. So it did have, it did it twice.
Don't know.
She had an administrative approval for it, so we changed the rules on her.
They're trying to do the right thing now. Sounds like.
Yeah, correct.
To also note, the one speaker in opposition, there were also two others that were there that didn't want to ask questions, but they were clearly with the person. So, again, this is why we brought it up, because there was potential of further opposition that could be here. One other item that I'll bring up that I do not have slides for is the council may be receiving questions in the clerk's office as well about Life's Journey, which is a conditional rezoning that was heard by the Planning Commission in June. That's on McNeil Avenue. That item, I will brief the council in September, and that item will be at the second meeting in September, currently tentatively scheduled. So just know that that will be coming, and that is the potential hearing date. That's all I have.
All right.
So we have several items for closed session.
Right. Mr. Bull?
Sure. I move the members of the council assemble informally closed meeting at 3:47.
Second. All right.
I'm in the 10th floor conference room of the City Hall building of the City of York.
The purposes which are set out in clause
29, 29, 29, 29, and 1. Of subsection A of section 2.2-3711 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended. Discussion of the award of a public contract on property located in the downtown area where discussion of the terms of the scope of the project in an open session would adversely affect the negotiating strategy. Clause 29, discussion of the award of a public contract on property located in the downtown area where discussion determine the scope of the project in open session would adversely affect negotiating strategy of the public body. Item 29, discussion of the award of public contract of property located in the Military Circle Area Ward 4 for discussion of the terms or scope of the project in an open session would adversely affect the negotiating strategy of the public body. Clause 29, discussion of the award of a public contract of property in the Ginton Area Ward 2, where discussion of the terms or scope of the project in an open session negotiating strategy of the public body. Clause 1, discussion of the boards, commissions, authorities, and committees for appointments. Clause 1, discussion of personnel issue related to the Chief Administrator of Public Safety's performance regarding law and form. Mrs. Jordan.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Ms. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.
Great.